Judy, I love it that like everyone spent the day with us and they're still watching the podcast too.
Oh, really?
These are awesome. Nice. She says, no, I'm not done yet. Just so you know, Dickens is watching now to pick up some more reactivity tricks, planning to bring his reactivity tomorrow.
Judy, I would hope so. This is what I want to do with you, Judy. Massive amounts of human coaching. That's what you need the most. You need the you need the human component. Judy, I'm super proud of you for being there. So many people are out of their comfort zones today. Could you imagine having a couple of people said, just coming in here with my dog is a win. Because mm-hmm. I never even thought yeah. that I'd be able to even make it through the door.
I think I got some of that on video, yeah. actually.
So, and then there's people that are out of the comfort zone. Do you know how hard it is? It's so funny because we haven't gotten this for a while, but sometimes you'll post a video of one of the people, one of the attendees who's had 30 seconds of training from me.
Yeah.
Like walking around the room. They brought their leash reactive dog to a fucking seminar, traveled up to 8 hours, mm-hmm. stayed in a hotel. Do you know that some people have never stayed in a hotel by themselves? Some people have never traveled by themselves before. Mm-hmm. Some people have never had a dog stay in a hotel before.
Oh my God, yeah.
Okay. It's like, they do all of that.
Yeah.
They drive to a seminar with a bunch of other reactive dogs. They come in and they're nervous as fuck. And then they're walking around and then you film it. And someone was like, oh my gosh. She's holding the leash. I'm like, you fucking asshole.
Leash skills.
It's like you have such little empathy for owners that are struggling. Mm-hmm. Like you really are a fucking asshole. Like, it doesn't get worse. You want to pick on someone? Pick on me. Mm-hmm. Pick on me. Don't you dare pick on the people in that video.
Yeah.
You don't pick on my staff. You don't pick on my clients. Don't pick on my seminar attendees. You got something to say, you pick on me. Because mm-hmm. I'll fucking just ban and delete your ass anyway. But don't you dare pick on the person that's fucking in the fucking arena doing the goddamn work. Mm-hmm. Can't stand that.
So true.
I can't stand it. So I'm looking forward to see you tomorrow, Judy.
How come my thing's not working?
Hmm?
Hold on.
Get on to the show. Hey, everybody. How are you? It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. This is my weekly, but actually I do this 3 times a week. You logging in, honey?
I'm trying.
Okay, let's go.
There we go.
There we go. All right. How's everybody doing? We're over here in...
All right. How's everybody doing? Volume works.
We're over here in Wisconsin. We're doing a seminar here at the Beckett School of Dog Training and Rehabilitation. Today was day one. Mm-hmm. And sorry for the late start. We're an hour behind, so we're in central time. So we originally thought we'd be able to make it for the 8 o'clock time, but we grabbed a quick dinner at a Mexican place. Big day today. It was a fantastic, fantastic seminar. Had a lot of fun. Tomorrow, a lot of progress. You got a lot of photos. And make sure you check us out on Instagram. Joelle put stuff up on IG stories, and she put stuff on just the regular Instagram feed. But a lot of IG story stuff goes up, I think.
I try.
You try. It's hard. But we got a lot of stuff documented from that. This coming weekend, after this, we're going to be in Atlanta. So you can go to jeffgellmanseminars.com, jeffgellmanseminars.com, and you can see see the schedule. What we do with the show is it's a Q&A show. You guys ask the questions. I give the answers. Joelle asks the questions. You type the questions. Joelle asks the questions.
And then ask them.
Okay. And I give them. Right at the bottom, underneath your name, it says say something. That's where you type in your questions. Underneath that is a dollar sign. The dollar sign is for something called Top Chat or Super Chat. It's something that YouTube does for creators like ourselves that put out lots of free content to help people. And it's a way that you folks can just give back if you want to. But the way that it works on the website, on the platform, that's because we're not sitting real close to each other. There we go. The way it works is your question will go up to the top of the queue. We see it right away and we'll answer it. And that's for some reason YouTube does it for $4.99 and up. But we'll eventually, you know, we try to get to every question. This is a 90-minute show we're doing right now. So here we go.
All righty. Sebastian I took my 7-month-old dog out to the front yard today. A random woman with her dog were walking by. Mm. I turn away with my dog, suddenly look back, and she had trespassed into my yard, and her dog is a foot away from mine. My dog jumped and bit and pulled from excitement, and when she asked if our dogs could meet, I said no. She walked away, pissed and angry. I'm carrying pepper spray now. Yeah. People are ridiculous. I'm working on distraction training with my dog currently. This really didn't help us.
No, it didn't. It, you know, it might have set you back a little bit. And this is the thing. We live in this, you know, it is what it is. We have to dummy-proof our dogs, why she felt like she can trespass with her dog on your private property. And if your dog would have bit that dog, you know, I don't know. I'm not a lawyer at all, but... You know, I mean, the dog did trespass on your property and you felt unsafe and so does your dog. I mean, this is the thing. It's becoming more and more of a problem. This is it, everybody. When you're out there walking your dogs, mind your own damn business. Okay? Stay in your lane. Mind your business. Nobody wants to meet your damn dog. Okay? Nobody's interested in meeting your damn dog. Okay? Like, take your dog. Take it for a walk. If you want it to socialize, join a puppy play group. Take it to daycare. I hate dog parks, but go to a dog park. But stay off of people's fucking front lawns. Next.
Aliazzi. Hey, Jeff and Joelle. Just got home from Daycare. 4 hours total drive time today, plus 9 to 5 seminar. Now 1.5 hour podcast. You two are relentless, hardworking animals. LOL. Thank you for all you do. Ken.
Ken.
Hey, Ken.
Ken, why don't you get a fucking hotel room?
Yeah, 4 hours.
Like, what are you doing? 2 hours. Get a hotel room, buddy. Congratulations on the drive, but hotels are cheap. You'd only need it for... technically one night tonight, right? Yeah, you probably drove there this morning. That's okay. If I had extra room in my room, I'd let you. All right.
Angela, we're taking a dog out in public. Taking our dog out in public to Home Depot and Petco. She's never been out there. Any suggestions?
Yeah, don't go. So don't go into Petco. Absolutely don't go into Petco. Petco is the Wild West with no rules and lots of assholes. So let's do that. Look, there's no sheriff. There's no sheriff there. So the first thing I would do is I don't know. I don't know anything about your dog. I don't know anything about your dog's behavior. I don't know anything about your skill set. I don't know about how far you are training. You know, Home Depot can freak dogs out because of the floors. It can freak dogs out because of all the noises. The last thing I'd want your dog to do is lunge at somebody at Home Depot or bark its head off. And then all of a sudden, they changed their policy that you can't take dogs to Home Depot. So if your dog knows how to behave in public, and if you can keep your dog in a proper heel, and if your dog does bark and you can shut it up instantly, and if you're really assertive by keeping people away from your dog, the big thing you want to do is use Home Depot as a distraction for your training. But literally stay in your lane. Teach your dog to ignore people and ignore environmentals. The reason why I don't suggest Petco is because it literally is the Wild West. It's a retail store with dogs on flexi leashes. I can't imagine a worst case scenario in my world. Next.
Rescues and focused dog training. Finally ordered a 2-dog e-collar system. Can't wait to see how much it improves the lock.
Awesome. Did you see all of Sebastian's?
Yeah, I read all that.
Oh God. Oh, those were multi-part. Got it. Awesome. A 2-dog system is good. The 302, the 402, 802, or Dogtra's, you know, whatever, you know, ones that they have, 282, 1902. 2-dog systems are great. Just if you ever make a mistake hitting the wrong button, and you shock the wrong dog, it happens. Next.
Michelle Anderson. Hi, Jeff and Joelle.
Hey, Michelle. How are you?
Okay. Cassandra. Hey, friends.
Hello, friend.
Hey, Cassandra. Melissa. Good evening,
Jeff. Hey, Melissa. How are you? Thanks for being here.
Sandra, place command for the win. Big thunderstorm today. New dog nervous. Gave her place command and she lay down and chilled. Fell asleep.
Yeah, that's the thing is that what do we do for fireworks and thunderstorms? It's like tell them what to do and reinforce it. Good job. Next.
Sandra, love that she now knows it gives her permission to relax no matter what. Thank you, Jeff, for upping my game.
Yeah, good job, Sandra. Super, super, super proud of you. Really, really am.
Dog works. How do you personally teach a full body down command, head down also?
There's a lot of different ways I imagine you can do it. Well, maybe half a dozen ways. We do it with a remote collar and leash pressure. Very, very, very often though, when a dog is in a down and we do low level continuous and we say down again, are you finding that dogs are just automatically doing it? Or do you find that you've got to do leash pressure as well?
Leash. Yeah. I don't think ever.
Yeah. Yep. They just do remote collar pressure. We did it at the seminar. We do it at the seminar too. So just low level leash pressure, head goes down. Next.
Rachel, what do you put in your turmeric paste?
Turmeric. let's see. Turmeric.
There has to be some sort of fat. So.
There's a little bit of cinnamon. There's
coconut oil?
Nope. There's an MC.
No, you don't use coconut oil?
I don't think so. There's some type of oil, but not a lot in it. A little bit of peanut butter. Once you've been mixing it up, just to add a little, take a little bit, some of that strong taste out of it. Interesting. I have the full recipe. I have the recipe at home. I don't have the recipe on me. Go to pet.nutrition. I'm sorry. Go to at pet.nutrition on Instagram.
There has to be a fat, though. The body doesn't absorb turmeric without fat.
There it is. I just don't know what it is.
Maybe the peanut butter, but.
No. There isn't. There's an oil. In other words, coconut oil.
I guess you could do olive oil.
Yeah, but coconut oil, when it's warm, it's a liquid.
Yeah.
I know. There's another oil that I use that already is in a liquid.
Got it.
I just don't know what it's called.
Got it.
Okay.
Kaylee J. Hey, Kaylee J.
Kaylee, it was nice to meet you.
Hey, Jeff and Dual. I learned a lot of new things to try with Arlo today. Excited for day two tomorrow.
And you're so talkative.
Hey, we put her on the spot today with that trick training. I got a good video.
Did you?
Yeah.
Good. Good. Kaylee J. was nice to meet you. Ken was nice to meet you. Guys, it's really, really nice to meet, you know, it's nice to meet just fans in general.
Yeah,
nice.
It is. Jose. Hey, Jeff. My friend bought a five-week-old GSD male, and he's not really eating much, just goat milk. Anything I should do to help the puppy? I told her bring it back, but owner won't reply anymore.
Yeah, no shit. Fuck. Okay. I would highly encourage that owner to figure a way to take that dog back. There's a lot of dogs out there that are probably better suited than a five-week-old German Shepherd, which struggles in life as it is. The dog at 5 weeks old, goat milk is probably a pretty good option. And there's, I haven't done pre 8 week old puppy raising to know what else to do. You know who would know?
Claire. She does goat milk with those puppies.
Anything else?
No, I think that's it.
That's all she does is goat milk.
Don't quote me on that, but I'm pretty sure that's all she did.
So
she wouldn't drink the formula.
What happened to the mother of the, what happened to the bitch?
She didn't want to take care of him.
Okay. So we have a new employee who is really good with puppies, and she got them at what, 3 weeks, 4 weeks old or something?
No, since birth.
Since the birth.
Mom wanted nothing to do
oh,
with
really?
Them.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. Holy shit. Goat milk. Yeah. But I would call a vet. Call a vet next.
Josue, I fell asleep with my bonker next to me because I was waiting to correct my pups when the mailman arrived for reactivity. Your YouTube live alert woke me up. LOL, I was ready.
Good.
Melissa posted the links to the seminars.
Nice. Thank you.
Cheryl, be prepared.
I'm just thinking of something like.
Someone breaks into the house. Bonk.
Right.
Cheryl, be prepared for the yellowing of Atlanta mega pollen. Oh, no.
What happened?
Gross. Pollen season in Atlanta.
Oh, I don't give a shit. Next.
Lisa, I plan on coming to the New Jersey seminar. I don't really have any problems with my 20-week pup, and she gets car sick. Do I really need to bring her? I'm really just coming to learn for myself.
So, Lisa, you don't need to bring her at all. In fact, working spots. No, I think there's one or two working spots left. Just come. You'll have fun. Just come for the weekend. You'll have a great time. No dog. Get an audit spot. Save some money. But you don't have any issues. You have a car sick dog. So we can help you with that. But you'll learn what we do for car sickness there. But you don't have any issues yet because it's only 5 weeks old. You're going to have issues. So what will happen is you'll learn a lot of how to resolve issues when they creep up. Next.
Caitlin, love watching Steve's and Jack's go home videos. Oh. They looked great. Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. They're doing a great job. You guys are doing a really, really good job with your go homes, and you're doing a really good job documenting it all.
Thanks.
And then editing it.
Thank you.
Yeah. And there's probably more you got too, I'm sure.
I have to do Murphy's.
Yeah. I mean, more of, we have even more content of like their go home stuff and things like that. Yeah. There's so much stuff we have.
It can only make it so long.
Yeah. I know. Yep. That's good. I'm proud of you.
Thanks.
Next.
Amanda, just got in for a 3 mile walk with our new mini educator, had a little leash reactivity and was in an amazing heel. Thank
awesome.
You so much, Jeff, for your free content.
All caps. Hey, for all the folks on Spotify, SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, Google platform, thank you very much. And if you're brand new to my world, make sure you subscribe to the channel, hit notifications. And then also, if you're not familiar with what we do, we work with a lot of aggression rehab, a lot of high-level leash reactivity, separation anxiety, shut down, nervous, fearful dogs, We put out so much social media. I make sure you follow our Instagram feed and our Facebook feed. That's where a lot of our content is. And on this show, as well as my seminars, we talk a lot about punishment. The reason why we talk so much about punishment is because most people are asking us how to stop unwanted behaviors. We're actually food and clicker trainers for our obedience. We reward dogs. We click for obedience. You know, we click as a marker when we want to teach dogs how to do stuff. But in order to stop an unwanted behavior, to decrease an unwanted behavior, to extinguish an unwanted behavior, you need to learn how to properly apply a punisher. Next.
Rescues and focused dog training. I played the replay of your bonker video at the shelter. Good stuff, sir.
Awesome. Hopefully people didn't get freaked out. Shelter folks can be a little bit sketchy on some of that stuff. And rescues and focused dog training. If you're in the shelter world and I've got a seminar that's close to you, let me know. I always have pro bono tickets available. Next.
Bianca, 1-year-old Malinois coonhound, constantly jumps fence and becomes oblivious to everything, even punishers. Also won't go into follow mode on prong collar, still pulls a bit, but turns away. I want him to.
Okay. So Bianca, the dog is not oblivious to punishers. You're actually not delivering a punisher to the dog, if that makes sense. A punisher is only, we can only call a punisher if it actually stops, extinguishes the behavior. So if it's not, it's actually not called a punisher. I know that sounds weird and it's like a little, what is that called? Wordplay?
A riddle.
No, a wordplay. Maybe you think I'm being a little bit snarky right now, but we use remote collars for other things besides punishment. So say you're using it at a high level, but the dog doesn't stop the behavior. Theoretically, it wasn't used as a punisher, even though on another dog, the same level might be. Or even that level might be a punisher on that dog doing something else. But when it's in high drive, leaping over a fence and trying to get away, you have to do...
Sorry.
It's okay.
We just leg was like falling asleep.
No, it's okay. I just thought we had a camera skip. You have to come up with a something. So if you're not using a shock collar, you haven't even walked into the world of punishment yet. And if you are, how high are you using it? And what model are you using? And make sure it's nice and snug. Next.
Jenny, have you ever worked with any wolf dogs?
Not a ton of them. I'm very cautious about the human behind the dog. I'm very cautious about the human behind the dog. That doesn't make sure, Jenny, that doesn't mean you if you happen to own one, but it might also be you. What makes a human get a wolf hybrid? What makes a human get a wolf hybrid? So, and then what's the lifestyle of the dog? And how wild is that dog? And you know what I mean? Where's that dog lived? Did it grow up? Literally, was it literally growing up in city life, apartment life? Or did you bring it in from the wilderness into like your world? So there's a lot of variables there. But as far as teaching it, yes, my skill set allows me to teach them. Meaning I've got full confidence that I can work with them. But just like any other client we work with, I pre-screen my clients. Not because I want easy clients. I don't actually. I want the perfect clients. What I mean by that is that when we work with the challenging dogs that we work, it's a lot of work for us and for them. And I want to make sure that those are the folks that are going to win. It's not about us. Every dog that comes to us, we have a very good level of success. It's variable because of the dogs we work with, but I want the owners to win. I want the owners to have great success. And if I don't feel that they will, then I don't want that dog as a client, because it's no good if I rehab the dog, but the client isn't going to follow through or win, and everybody's on the same page as well as a level of expectation. But a wolf dog, the human characteristics behind that human, I'm very interested in knowing what the motivation is before I would work with them. Next.
Jenny, hello. Recently we started e-collar training and a prong collar on also, but every time I correct for heel, he will do it for a second and proceed to move up. Putting the e-collar level makes him yelp.
There's a couple of variables there. Try my 180 move. Don't be misled by yelping. That could be manipulative. Also, I don't know about your leash handling skills. I don't know about your timing at all. Watch my 180 video. My 180 video. Also, what I want you to do is, do we have any video of the front heel tap? Did you capture that today?
I think so.
Can capture that tomorrow when we're doing walks outside. I'll be like, hey, I'm going to do a front heel tap to a dog. Capture that, and we'll turn that into a little bit of a snippet.
Okay. Yeah,
I know people are going to give me a hard time because I'm
yep.
nailing a dog in the chest with my foot. I know. Top chat. What is the best way to train my dog from running a circle around me as we going from the crate to the back door? It's a trip hazard anyway to do this off leash. I'm a mini educator. I would do it on a slip lead first, but I would actually get a bonker. I don't have a bonker with me, but I just did almost an hour podcast on bonking last night, and I've got a how-to bonker video on my YouTube channel. I would say no and bonk the dog. No, bonk the dog. But I would also teach that dog to come out of the kennel and go into a down. Come on, like go into a sit. But let's just stop the arousal first. So no bonk. If you got to make sure you target the dog as it goes around in a circle. It's a learned behavior. Technically, you train the dog to do that, which doesn't mean you did it on purpose, but the lack of stopping it trains it. So you need to break the cycle. Next.
Sebastian, fortunately, my dog is past the barking anytime we see a dog stage. He was super excited and jumped, but I'm proud considering he didn't have a negative reaction.
Good. Proud of you, Sebastian.
The Pichu. Hi, Jeff and Joelle. I always think of stuff I could ask you, but I usually forget them. I'll try to remember something.
The Pichu. That's the same bullshit.
Every show.
That's the same bullshit excuse you used last show.
Write it down.
Pichu. In your phone. Notes. Come up with something. Talk right in your phone. Just be questions for Jeff and Joelle. Make it own category, writing your notes. Okay? Next.
Rachel observed a positive reinforcement only dog trainer, which was a complete joke. She came into my work with her dog who had no interest in listening to her. Just goes to show her technique does not work.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing though, Rachel. So she just might have sucked. Right? She just might have sucked. We also do positive training as well, which, because that's how we train commands. Her skill set might have just been terrible, which isn't a surprise. I mean, there's good and bad dog trainers in every category of the spectrum, whether it's sport dog, agility, balance training. But historically, unfortunately, during high levels of distraction in a new place, for a dog that's based on reward-based training, that's never been held accountable for non-compliance, you obviously absolutely saw the flaw in it, which is too bad, because if she was bringing the dog in to demo it of her skill set, that's not good. That's not good. It's like the proof is in the pudding, right? So next, $50 top chat. Canine Gunner Tactical, had a client consult yesterday, huge Jeff fan, really, has a dog who has bitten a couple people but had an excuse of why the dog made those decisions. I told her Jeff would tell you the same thing. Stop making excuses and hold the dog accountable. So Canine Gunner Tactical, it's really cool because you can be like, you just actually throw it right back at him. Throw it back at him, say, what would Jeff say about that? What would Jeff say about that? Lily, that's like your whole consult. That's your whole consult. So Brady, thank you so much. Looks like you're doing some traveling. So kudos to that. That looks really, really cool. Be excited to get out there at some point, but hope everything's going well with you up north. We're out west right now. Next.
Wherever we are.
Yep.
Karen, GSD lover, good evening. Welcome to Wisconsin. Your grocery shopping trip on IG was entertaining. You feed your attendees well. That was so funny. How about those people at the register with their accents?
So, whoa. First of all, take that comment back.
Why?
Second of all.
They were so nice.
So, with their accents?
Yeah,
like it's some cute little thing. Like it's a novelty.
People do it to us.
No, they don't.
She's like, did I hear someone from Massachusetts over there?
Not because of the way you talked.
She knew.
No, you said the word Massachusetts because the gentleman behind us was talking.
But then we started talking about our accents. And I was like, pack the car. And she was like, in Havignon.
Yeah, but nobody talks like that. Okay? Nobody talks like that.
I used to have a really bad accent.
But that's a stereotype. It's a stereotype.
Everyone has accents.
No, they don't. Okay, listen.
Okay.
Joelle.
Like, people have accents depending on where they're from.
First,
you can't deny it.
Can I just clarify something?
No.
You just love to pick. You must be tired because you love to pick fights with me.
I'm so tired.
Let's pick a fight with Jeff. It's so funny because when we're on the road, it's sort of like I'm not the boss. So she can like, she can get away with this stuff. There's not much I can say except for you're not traveling with me anymore. But then I'm screwing myself actually technically because then like she's the best thing I've got, you know? So that the food tour wasn't for the attendees. That was just me in amazement. And if you don't know what we're talking about, is it still up? It's only up for 24 hours.
Probably up until for a little while.
Yeah, I would jump on the IG stories. Food porn galore. Next.
Chris, we got our dog a treadmill, and I would like to know what you think is a good goal speed and length of time.
Chris, I don't know. Don't worry about what I think. Speed-wise, I can't tell you. Start at 1 mile per hour. Get the dog up to 2 miles per hour. Your average dog will walk about 2.5 miles per hour. Okay. If it's too slow, it can be hard for the dog to learn it. As far as time, start at a couple minutes, but if your dog takes to it really well, I mean, technically you have your dog on there for hours. So my Malinois can be on there for 5 hours. He doesn't give a shit. He's a Malinois, you know? So, you know, start out slow and conservative. I would do that next. And watch my how-to videos on that next.
Didi, sorry I haven't been here working and I'm part of a paranormal group. Jeff, I want to send you a video of Zoya's progress with e-collar. Where do I send it?
Videos usually don't make it to me really well because I usually don't have time to watch them. What a lot of people are doing though is they're putting it up on their Instagram feed and they're tagging us. That's what a lot of people have been doing lately. So they're doing that. And then what I do is I share it right in our Instagram feed as well. A lot of videos don't make it to me. I also don't open up files from people. So I don't open up files from people. So, cause I'm just weird like that. So I would put it up and trust me, I want to know how well your dog is doing. So if you put it up on your Facebook page or put it up on your Instagram page and tell me where to go, I will definitely go check it out. Next.
Jason, I feed my dog raw and I want to do some trick training. What kind of food would you recommend to use?
You can use dried liver or you can dry raw food, spread it out on a food dehydrator. Just use dehydrated food, but they make dried liver already made too. Next.
Matthew Little. Totally. I had. That's it. I don't know where the rest is.
Hey, Matthew.
Hey, Matthew. Kelsey. Hey, J&J, I just want to say, Apollo, my ACD is doing so much better with the advice you gave me last stream and your videos. Still having a problem with cats, though. Any tips?
Yeah, so if your dog is going,
Hold on, there's more. Very reactive to them, like chasing after them. Doesn't try to hurt them, just likes to chase and mouth.
Okay, just make it suck. Shock collar on your dog. Dog goes after the cat. Make it suck to do that. And how do you do that? You just say no and stim. How high of a level? A level high enough for the dog to go. Cats, not interested. Top chat for $10. Elizabeth, hey Elizabeth, how are you? Any potty training tips for a one-year-old dog goes out often but still pisses and shits in the house? I have an e-collar that goes to 100. I got up to a 40 and he doesn't care. So I don't historically correct dogs for shitting in the house. I usually take 100% responsibility and it's be like, owner fucked up. So that's usually an owner fail on that. What I would do is, your dog might be going out too much. What I mean by that is you're not teaching your dog to hold it. You're not teaching your dog to hold it. So a one-year-old dog should be able to go, you know, technically 8 hours, right? So what I would do is no free roaming. So the way I like to look at it is what's your dog who shits and pisses in the house allowing to do walking around the home looking for places to shit and piss. So instead, where's your dog? So your dog, I don't have my dogs with me right now. I flew here. But when I'm back home, you see them in my office. They're inside my office and they're lying down next to me. When they're at work, they're lying down next to me. So, you know, I make a routine for them. I take them out a certain amount of time. I monitor their food. I monitor their water. And that's what I do. Also, are you not crating your dog? Crate your dog at night, crate your dog when you're not home. All right, next.
Official 7-dog squad, 5-year-old GSD and 4-year-old Husky, both female, used to get along. Now they fight on site. We crate and rotate, but wondering if you think there's hope for them to ever coexist peacefully.
So I don't know if there is. It's a 50-50 chance. it's a pretty detailed protocol that we do. If you have other dogs in the house, that could be a pretty big variable as well. What we do is we muzzle up the dogs, remote collars on them, and we make it pretty horrific for them to try to fight. We put them into avoidance. That gives us a level of safety to start working with them now. Now what we do is we start from the basics and we get them to exist with each other. Are you ever going to be able to trust these dogs unsupervised? That shouldn't be even in the game plan right now. That shouldn't even be in top. What the fuck is that noise?
There's like so much ruckus going on around here.
Do you guys hear that? That's coming from the hallway.
It's like always partying going on around here. And it's
and there, these women are in their 60s, 70s, and 80s. So today we had pizza today for lunch. So we had extra pizzas. This is how bad my potty mouth is. So I bring two pizzas and I put it in the
lobby
kitchen area. And there's a couple of women there. They're like three women in their 80s that are there, maybe in their 70s, late 70s. And I'm like, oh, hey, guys, you know, we had some extra pizzas from our seminar. I thought, you know, maybe because there was a group of them there yesterday. There was a ton of older people there yesterday. And I said, or maybe I figured anybody would want them. And the woman goes, we didn't order any pizzas. I'm like, no. I know you didn't. I said, I'm bringing them for my seminar. They're extra. We don't want them. You're more than welcome to have them. She goes, what kind of pizzas are they? I'm like, I said, they're free fucking pizzas. And I'm like, oh shit.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry. I like that's something I would say like anywhere else. Mm-hmm. But I wasn't like
you guys, there's so much more that goes on in that lobby down there. Like as soon as he walked in tonight, she's like, I knew you were trouble.
So what you're gonna do is this. This is who asked that question? It's Official Seven Dogs. This is a Skype session. This is like literally massive amounts of interaction between you and me. Is there hope? There's always hope. Right now, do crate and rotate. I would get them into avoidance as quick as possible. We do that with remote collars. We literally want to make it so they're the last thing they're thinking about is fighting. Then we try to get them to exist with each other. We do that through duration work in the same room on tie backs. We do it through migration with walks. We do no big food protocols. We do right now no high level praise. Don't try to convince them to be friends. It can be done. We have done it. We have also failed. Next.
Nicole, dog growls as it plays with a 6-month old puppy. The problem is the puppy doesn't understand boundaries. And when they play, the dog is growling, but the puppy is used to growling. So he doesn't stop.
So I'm not opposed to growling during play. Do you think that the older dog wants it to stop? Because if it did, it could give it a quick nip. It could be just rough play. My dogs also growl when they rough play, and I allow them to. A lot of dogs do that. So growling is not always bad in that context. So if you want it to stop, what we do is we would just take a dressage. We just do a stockyard whip, take a stockyard whip. We just tap it on the ass of the puppy when the dog is growling. But For all you know, that's play. Most dogs are pretty good at giving a little bit of a warning bite. Next.
Robert, Jeff, how is the e-collar used for leash reactivity? Dog ran up to us today and the prong collar did nothing to stop my dog from lunging. I should have distracted him, but he laid down.
Distracted who?
The dog, I guess.
So if a dog runs up to my dog, I'm more concerned about neutralizing the threat than I am about my dog's behavior. So what we'll do is, what could the last thing I would do with a remote collar is, if a dog literally is running, and we're talking about, I don't know how close the dog came, but if a dog ran up to my dog and my dog started freaking out, I probably wouldn't correct my dog. This is the hard part. It's like, do you correct your dog for a dog running right up to it? I mean, I would remove the other dog through physical force, you know, because I have to protect my pack, protect myself. I've got to advocate for my dog and myself, and if I'm with my family and with other dogs. But the way, let's go in a backtrack. The question is, how do we use a remote collar for leash reactivity? Is we make it suck to be leash reactive. And then we use, and that's at a high level. And then we use lower levels when the dog starts scanning, loading, posturing. So we do all of that. And there are people out there who will blatantly say you shouldn't punish a dog for leash reactivity. That's an unethical, blatant lie. An unethical, blatant lie that has absolutely zero truth whatsoever. That is false words. And that's fraudulent, unethical statement. But it is being said, and it's also stupid. If you really think about it, it's stupid. It's like you don't apply a punisher to an unwanted behavior such as leash reactivity. Well, then what exactly do you do? Redirect it? Really? My dog is at the end of the leash exploding. I'm going to redirect that? Show me. I'm waiting for that video. That just doesn't exist. It's the biggest bunch of bullshit out there. Meanwhile, we stop leash reactivity in seconds. And then now we work on the dog, the thought process. So if your dog was being leash reactive, we would do it we wouldn't train the dog with an off-leash dog running up to it. We would do it with massive safety protocols, with another handler, with another dog. Your dog would walk by, it would be leash reactive. We would, step one, make it suck. How high? High enough to suck for the dog. It goes, holy shit, that sucked. Muzzle the dog up. It might redirect. It's possible. It's not because you're using a shock collar. I've had dogs redirect on me just by reining the dog in from leash reactivity. I've had a dog on a flat buckle collar that I've had to rein in. It turned and it bit me. No equipment. And reining a dog in ain't no correction. So it's just energy. So it could happen. So, and then, great, we made it suck. Now we start the work. Next.
Jackie, have almost all crate anxiety fixed with e-collar, but still struggling with dog peeing in kennel and laying in it. Dog goes outside and pees before kennel, then already ruled out UTI medical help.
Yeah, so he could be, we call them, you know, you call them a dirty dog. Dogs that freaking lay in their piss and don't care about it. Lay in their shit and don't care about it. I wish your dog bit instead, to be frank with you. So it's easier to fix. What I want you to do is this. I want you to make your crate, you know how you can shrink your crate? So you can shrink your crate. I want you to make it so you actually can also lower the roof of the crate. So you're going to be putting a barrier in lower. So the dog has to crawl into the crate. This isn't forever at all. We're not doing this forever. You're getting it so your dog can't stand up. Can't stand up, historically, can't piss, can't take your shit. All right? Next.
Nancy, how do you teach your dog to ignore people and environmentals?
It's a process. For my Canadian friends, and I'll use my accent, it's a process.
Oh, that's so, like, stereotypical. Sorry.
But you have to say sorry 3 to 4 times.
Okay, stereotypes.
So.
Noted. I'm just going to put that one away for...
If anybody ever wants to know how to push this lady's buttons here, just let me know. I'll give you a whole list.
It's pretty long. Everything.
Hang out with you 24/7, just about.
Yeah.
Especially RV life. It's really interesting. So what I want you to do is this. For starters, do this. Your dog doesn't meet people or dogs on a walk. Simple as that. Get your dog to be you are everything to your dog. That's what I want you to do. You're everything to your dog. Okay. So if it looks at something, you can correct it. You know, it's like, you don't need to look at that. Get the dog in follow mode, which is behind your leg, state of mind. All the dogs that are like, you know, with their ears down, looking shut down and submissive and like, oh my gosh, they look so afraid. They're not. They're calm. And following, calm and following. If anybody just watched National Geographic for a couple of episodes of dogs just walking, not running through the woods, not circling for a hunt, You know, I'm almost envisioning like wolves migrating great distances. And there's all the wolves in the pack historically are, they're in work mode. They're like trudging along. They're covering great distances. The one in the front is usually on alert. The one in the ones in the back of any probably, you know, not just dogs, but a lot of animals. They're just like, we're going great distances. We're migrating. You know, any of these animals that cover great distances, they're like, yep, we're going, especially predators. Especially when you have a predator, which dog is a predator. So you have them going. So you do that. Just teach your dog to be, and then you're everything to your dog. Hold your dog accountable for everything. Next. Mm-hmm.
V100, thanks for doing this for the world. Question, my 2-year-old German Shepherd runs into each and every one of my other dogs while playing with toys. Is this normal?
Yeah, it is. And if it pissed off the other dogs, they'd freaking tell them to fuck off. You know what I mean? In dog language, you know, it would be just a growl and a nip. Like, get out of here. Yeah, it's just, is it normal? My dogs don't do that, but I'm sure other people watching this, their dogs do it. And is it okay? If it caused a dog fight, it's not okay. But other than that, if it bothered the dogs, they would let the dog know. I'd like to think. Next.
Tara. Hey, Jeff and Joelle. Happy to be tuning in.
Happy to be here.
Happy to have you, Tara.
I'm tired tonight.
Me too.
Yeah, a little sluggish tonight. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's been long.
Because we didn't have any coffee this afternoon.
I know.
We're trying to cut out coffee in the afternoon.
How'd you sleep last night?
Horribly.
Yeah, me too. Mm-hmm. What time did I see you? Oh, I saw you, what, 4:35 in the morning? I met you by 7 minutes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm like, damn. She's in the lobby before I am.
Surprised you even posted it.
Why?
Because you're always ripping on me for being late and sleeping in.
I show your wins.
Appreciate it.
I show your wins.
All 7 minutes of them. Barb. Trying to send on Super Chat. No question. Just big thank yous.
You, I think it's hooked up to, guys, help me out here. Is it hooked up to, your Apple account, your Apple money, yeah. Apple cash? I don't know how it works. Next.
Sebastian. Also, he held a 90-minute downstay at a recent appointment. My dog is a service dog, by the way. He got up once to reposition so he wasn't stepped on, was a bit sniffy, but happy. Thanks for all the tips.
Awesome, Sebastian. Proud of you, buddy. Next.
Megan, I bought a new house. Any tips for moving with dogs?
Megan? Oh. No, but I'll put your match.com, design your match.com profile, young lady.
Look at you. That was quick.
Megan?
God, we see her like 3 weeks.
That's what happens when I fucking yell at her.
I guess that's what she needed.
She needed it. She needed a good talking to. So, Megan, I'm super proud of you.
Me too.
I know it wasn't easy for you, I know it was difficult for you. And I'm glad for this next step of your life. And if there's any other ladies out there that want to leave their partner but don't have the courage to do it, I'll talk some sense into you.
Such a straight.
I will set you fucking straight. Life is short.
Join the club, Megan.
Join the club. Life
don't
is
make t-shirts.
Life is too short to be fucking miserable. Mm-hmm. Got it? Life is too short to be miserable. As far as moving with dogs, structure, 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 structure. So my dogs, when I travel all of North America, Canada, California, Florida, they never know where we are because they don't understand accents. Okay? So they don't know.
What? I wasn't paying attention
to you
whatsoever.
I know you were too.
Okay, I'm sure some dig at me. It's fine. My blood pressure is high enough today. Nancy, I'm using a slip lead and hanging her for a few seconds and muzzling her. She focuses on everything outside.
You know, slip lead and hanging?
The dog.
For what?
Muzzling her. She focuses on everything outside. I have no idea.
Nancy, what are you doing? How do you teach your dog to ignore people and environmentals?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, don't do that, Nancy. Stop using a slip lead, okay? Get yourself a proper prong collar. Don't be hanging your dog. Get yourself a proper prong collar. Teach your dog how to properly heel next to you. You know how hard it is to walk a dog on a slip lead or even a choke chain? It's very hard for your average dog owner to do that. So get a prong collar and make your life so much easier. Next.
K. Karen GSD lover, was watching your older videos where you recommended dog tra. Do you now prefer e-collar technologies more than dog tra?
Yeah, I do. E-collar technologies was not around when I made those videos, or they were just in their infancy. And they're still working out some technical difficulties. Yep. But dog tra, I'll use. Like, we had, what, two people had dog tra e-collars today at the seminar. Mm-hmm. I'll use a dog tra e-collar. You know, we don't stock them, and we don't use them in our training center. But if somebody walks in with them, we'll use them. Yep. Next.
Dog works. What
about? Hold on. There's $5 top chat. Yeah. Sorry. Chris Parker, thanks for your answer. My Aussie is going 8 minutes, 1.6 miles per hour. When did I get on the treadmill with your free advice? Oh, awesome. Cool. So it's an Aussie, like an Australian Shepherd. You can probably go up to two miles per hour. Awesome. Proud of you.
Dog Works donated
$1.99. Dog Works, thank you.
What about with no e-collar stim, just leash? I don't know what that's in regards
to. For the down.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You would just do leash pressure. You do leash pressure, but it's a different feeling. I'm telling you, it's such a different sensation to do a low level stim to get that head down. It's hands-free. Your dog can even be in a crate and it's hands-free. But if you didn't have the remote collar, you'd have to be down and then leash pressure. Next.
Karen GSD lover says probably MCT oil.
Thank you. MCT oil. That's what it is.
Cool.
That would be the fat that makes the turmeric paste work.
Cool. Rick.
Thank you, Karen, for helping me out there today.
How do you know the difference between puppy play and puppy aggression? Our 10-week-old puppy plays, attacks our 1-year-old dog.
So I highly doubt your 10-week-old dog is aggressive. It's just being a 10-week-old dog. And if anybody said this dog is aggressive, I would really question their decision-making moving forward on any advice they gave. So if it was being aggressive, then I imagine your 1-year-old dog would say, go fuck yourself and destroy it.
Mm-hmm.
Unless, yeah. So chances are it's rough play. Is it acceptable? You know, I'd have to see video. Don't send me video because you have to do a Skype session for that. I don't have time to go through all these videos. But chances are it's just 10-week-old behavior. And hopefully your other dog will tell the dog to piss off one day. Next.
Leesboro, Judy. I love it that like everyone spent the day with us and they're still watching the podcast too.
Oh, really?
These are awesome.
Next.
She says, no, I'm not done yet. Just so you know, Dickens is watching now to pick up some more reactivity tricks, planning to bring his reactivity tomorrow.
Judy, I would hope so. This is what I want to do with you, Judy. Massive amounts of human coaching. That's what you need the most. You need the human component. Judy, I'm super proud of you for being there. So many people are out of their comfort zones today. Could you imagine having a couple of people said, just coming in here with my dog is a win. Because mm-hmm. I never even thought yeah. that I'd be able to even make it through the door.
I think I got some of that on video, yeah. actually.
So, and then there's people that are out of the comfort zone. Do you know how hard it is? It's so funny because we haven't gotten this for a while, but sometimes you'll post a video of one of the attendees who's had 30 seconds of training from me.
Yeah.
Like walking around the room. They brought their leash reactive dog to a fucking seminar, traveled up to 8 hours,
mm-hmm.
stayed in a hotel. Do you know that some people have never stayed in a hotel by themselves? Some people have never traveled by themselves before.
Mm-hmm.
Some people have never had a dog stay in a hotel before.
Oh my God, yeah.
Okay. It's like, they do all of that.
Yeah.
They drive to a seminar with a bunch of other reactive dogs. They come in and they're nervous as fuck. And then they're walking around and then you film it. And someone was like, oh my gosh. She's holding the leash. I'm like, you fucking asshole.
Leash skills.
It's like, you have such little empathy for owners that are struggling.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you really are a fucking asshole.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it doesn't get worse. You want to pick on someone? Pick on me. Mm-hmm. Pick on me. Don't you dare pick on the people in that video.
Yeah.
You don't pick on my staff. You don't pick on my clients. Don't pick on my seminar attendees. You got something to say, you pick on me. Because I'll fucking just ban and delete your ass anyway. But don't you dare pick on the person that's fucking in the fucking arena doing the goddamn work. Mm-hmm. Can't stand that.
So true.
I can't stand it. So I'm looking forward to see you tomorrow, Judy.
Cassandra, I wanted to share some of my dog's success with you. This week, he stayed in place for hours in the middle of a busy ICU while I added on patients with my team. I'm so proud of him.
Holy shit, Cassandra.
Nice.
Damn. Are you guys putting stuff on Instagram? Okay. Put this stuff on your Instagram stories and tag us. Mm-hmm. It goes right up on our stories. I want to share your successes. This is fucking awesome stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm just the guy who's freaking exhausted as hell right now, opening up my big mouth. I don't even think I've sworn at all tonight. So you know I'm tired when I'm not swearing. Next.
Nancy, should I push her and flood her? She is anxious. Using CBD just started. That's the dog that is.
No. Nancy, you're moving too fast. Nancy, you're the one. You're moving too fast. You're moving way too fast. No. Take a step back, Nancy. We're going from a slip lead to hanging her to pushing her and flooding her. Please slow down. Slow down. You're too far ahead. You're too far ahead. Get yourself the proper tools first. No flooding yet. Teach your dog the basics, how to walk politely on a leash next to you with no distractions. Work on that. Do variable speeds with your walk. Get your dog to look away from slight distractions that normally don't make the dog react. If you can't get your dog to look away, from slight distractions, good luck with dogs. Please don't flood the dog and push the dog right now. Take a step back. Next.
Rescues and focused dog training. I'm teaching the pups to walk politely using a slip lead e-collar combo. I want to learn to not pull regardless of collar.
That's going to take some work, but you can do it. But don't worry about the collar. I always want everyone's life to be easier. Like, why do we use prong collars and remote collars? We'll use remote collars for a lot of reasons. Number one, off-leash reliability, state of mind, high-level distraction, and commands at a distance. So that's one thing. But we also use it to make the owner's life easy. But prong collar we use very specifically for directional control and leverage for the lack of skill set of an owner. And it really, really helps. So to me, like, if I'm walking my dogs, they're on prong collars. They all can walk on slip leads. I mean, they do off leash heels, so they can all walk off leash. But there's leash laws. So to me, if I walk my dogs on a slip lead, three high drive dogs, out in the middle of nowhere, lots of environmentals. Like, I'm just not interested in that. Like, throw prong collars on the dogs. Make my life easy. I just want to make my life easy. Next.
Barb, $2. No questions. Just big thank yous. Have my good dogs back.
Awesome.
Woohoo. Sarah, worked through bad leash reactivity, but need to help his fear. He heard a dog bark on the walk and startled and went to hide behind me. I threw him back into heel. Anything else I should do to help?
This is what I want you to do. We demonstrated this a little bit today. Leash reactive dog, right? Mm. Okay. Your dog's leash reactive. It's not being leash reactive now, and now it's moving a little bit behind you. We actually allow the dog to do that for a little bit because it's better than lunging out. So I'm glad now the dog is moving away from the pressure. Before, I used to take the pressure and push it away. How do I get this pressure away from me? I lunge at it. Now the dog is going, you know what? How do I get that pressure away from me? I move a little bit out of it. Eventually, yes, we absolutely move the dog back into position, but we allow the dog and recognize the dog. And actually, we can even say, hey, thanks for letting me know. You don't have to say that, but that's the thought process that goes through my mind. I'm like, oh, that's a good choice. You're uncomfortable. You move behind me. I'll take that for now because I don't give out scores. I don't give out points. Winning is making it through life the end of the day is least amount of stress as possible, keeping the dog in the home. So, all right, next.
Jay Noakes, lost our 14-year-old heeler. Something bumped me. And the two heelers we have now, two-year-old male and female, fighting for who is the alpha.
That's very common. You lose your most dominant dog, and now you're left with a shit show. So what it means is you just need to step up your game, more structure, more consequences, and don't let them play that bullshit game. Next.
Sandra, hope it's not rude to say. Love the highlights, Joelle. Looks great.
No, no, you can compliment the fuck out of her.
Thank you.
We can do a whole show and just talk about how beautiful and wonderful and great personality she is and how much we love her accents. You know, she'll love it. She will love it. That's a 2-hour show easily.
Sounds so shallow. Jacob, literally I'm the most low maintenance person ever. Let them know. Let the people know.
Okay.
Let them know.
Can I please talk?
Yes.
Okay. Joelle is one of the easiest people that I've ever traveled with in my life. She's very low maintenance. She gets ready in a flash. She is no nonsense. We get each other. And I can't travel with many people. So,
same.
So yes.
Thank you. That's very kind. Okay. Jacob, great day one of seminar. Dog is exhausted. Excited for day two.
Awesome. It's really, really funny because we got a lot of feedback from people with their dogs today. And just to let you know, dogs spent 90% of the day in their crates today on day one of the seminar. Probably 90%, right?
Mm-hmm.
Probably 90.
Yeah.
And dogs are still exhausted. Why? It's hard for a dog to not be a dick all day. That's what it boils down to. It's really hard. Shut up in your crate. Don't react. Be polite. Come out politely. Mm-hmm. Yep. And they're exhausted. Now you can't do that every day. Your dogs do need like activity, but it just goes to show the power of
being calm.
Being calm in downtime. Yep. Mm-hmm. Next.
Mike, hey guys, I can't think of any questions tonight, but want to say hi and love you guys. Really appreciate you.
Mike, thank you so much.
So nice. Hi, Mike. Charisse, I wish I would have known about the pro bono tickets for shelter workers. I would have really loved to see you when you came to Maryland.
Yeah, I do that all the time. I do that all the time. I don't have a ton. It all depends on space, but I do $100,000 a year in pro bono work. So I've got some cities I've got more than others. Next.
Shona, Jeff, can you explain more about your I just read that, didn't I?
Mm-hmm.
About your pro bono tanks for people in the shelter world? Oh, yeah. This is a different one, though.
Yeah.
I volunteer with the dog behavior team at a shelter in Austin. Would love to see you in November.
Wow. Yeah, message me. Yeah, November. Yep, November, right before Hawaii. Yep.
Ooh, Hawaii. No. Kaylee J. LOL, yeah, I'm pretty shy and reserved with new people. It was good to meet you guys today, too.
Right, next.
We had no idea.
We had no idea you were actually
didn't
even fucking
say one word. I had to, like, stalk. I'm like, all right, where's Kaylee?
We had no idea you were even happy to be there.
I have some pictures of her smiling.
I know.
Canine Gunner Tactical, keep up the amazing work, guys. Love y'all.
Thanks.
Thanks, Brady.
Thanks.
Brandy, 3-month-old DSD, when he's on a leash in the yard, he pulls in all directions or lays down and won't move. When we try to get him to go with us, when in public, he almost refuses to walk. Any tips?
Yep. So what I want you to do is north, south, east, west protocol. Let's pretend you're heading north, which is just the way you're going. Okay. Even though it's not due north, let's call it north, right? Dog lays down. Go the opposite way. Go south. Dog should move. If he doesn't move, and if he does move, swing back around. If he doesn't move, head east. Head west. Go north again. Try that. I have no problem bending down, giving a little bit of encouragement. Come on, let's go. It's like you'd be surprised. I allow that at the beginning of this sequence. If you have a remote collar, cut the shit. Make a move. Next.
Seifel. I heard dogs go through a rebellious stage around 1 year or so. Mm-hmm. Should I prepare for my puppy's rebellion with more obedience training, or is there something else I can do?
So, I mean, rebellion. I'm not sure how you are on prayer. Try that if you want to, but you're probably better off not relying on the gods for that one.
The rebellion is coming.
Okay, it's coming. Okay, because they don't give a shit. All right, Okay. The Vikings didn't care. Okay. They're coming after you. They're coming after your women and your jewelry. So, and your property. So what I would do is, you sometimes see it as early as 9 months. Yeah. Dogs can be dicks pretty much up until they're dead. So, I mean, you can go through. So what I would do is step it up. Next.
Random American. She's right. We all have accents from another perspective.
I know. I was busting her balls. Next.
Thank you, Random American. Kelsey, also, I've always wanted to feed my dogs raw, but my mother heavily disagrees. She says raw meat makes dogs aggressive, and she'd not visit anymore if I did. I don't believe that. Thoughts?
Well, I would actually probably say, Mom, you're right, and I'm feeding it raw. Okay? It's called winning. Next.
Duke 2. Hi, my dog is good when in work mode, in command, hold place around other dogs without a problem. But once they say break, she goes ballistic. Want her to chill, walking around like your socialization group, not sprinting around, getting other dogs excited when I say break. P.S. Oh. Good job, Joel, training Jeff. He's looking fit.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you. Yeah. Good. Thank you so much, Joel. So this is the thing. We use a stockyard whip for that. Your dog's running around like crazy. And I get it. Some people are going to be like, you whip your dog. I would never do that. I'm aware of everything I say. And I'm aware of people's perceptions of what I say. And I'm aware of the negativity that's floating around out there of what I say. I'm not ignorant and I'm not stupid. Okay. I see it all the time. Trust me. People tell me like, I'm a dick many times a day, and like, I get it. Okay. So it just doesn't bother me, and I don't give a flying fuck what people say. So, but when the point is with a stockyard whip, it's like, you're not whipping your dog. So this is what we do. Stockyard whip, look them up, guys. It's, if you're in the horse world, you know what a stockyard whip is, but instead it doesn't have a long drop to it. So it's a 48 to 52 inch, you know, shaft with an 8-inch drop. So just an 8-inch drop. With a lot of the horses, you guys have like a, geez, what is that, about an 8-foot drop? Because you're doing different work with your horses. What we do is this, say, lead the dog into the yard calmly, take off the leash. When you say break, don't go break, just go break. Dog starts running around, follow your dog around, quick double tap to the ass. The dog goes, whoa, that sucked. And they immediately go, okay, I'll be a gentleman or a lady. Next.
Bianca, my Malinois hound mix also pulls a bit on the prong collar. How can I get him to stop this?
Watch my 180 video. In my search box on my YouTube channel, type in 180. Next.
RB, I'm adopting a 3-year-old dog next week. What is the best way to greet him for the first time and best way to establish our relationship in the first week? Thank you.
So RB, imagine what we do, not love and affection, not love and affection. Okay. Imagine what we do at our board and train. Dog comes in to the board and train, and I don't care how well behaved and trained this dog is. That's with its current people. Say the dog is incredibly well trained. That's with them though. That doesn't mean with you. Say the dog's a basket case. It doesn't need love and affection. So dog comes into us for board and train. What do you think we do for the first week? Minimal affection, lots of structure, stop unwanted behaviors, start teaching all the basics, hold the dog accountable. Everybody should be doing that with their dog. Start the relationship off right. Next.
Matthew, sorry, my keyboard died. We have a new Dobie following all of your advice. And guess what? It works, people.
Oh, you must have a wireless keyboard. Mm, yeah. Did you plug in your USB port or something and charge it? Yeah. Cool.
Tara, it's okay, Joelle. Don't feel bad about our goofy ass accents. Wait till Fargo seminar. Our accents get worse. Oh, well. I can't wait. I love accents. Imos, hi from Holland, guys. Been watching tons of your videos to rehab my first dog. People aggression, anxiety, etc.
Jeez.
Love you, 95% good, but 5% quick and sudden aggression. Unsure why. What would Jeff do?
Welcome to the club. That's what we get hired for. We get hired for 5%. So 5% is our hirer. That's it. Most dogs aren't aggressive all the time. So what do? People aggression is a hard one. I don't know your skill set. I don't know the dog. I don't know Netherlands. I don't know what your access to tools are over there in the Netherlands. What I want you to do is you get, own a muzzle, number one. We do a bunch of clicker and food counter conditioning protocols with all of our human aggressive dogs. A bunch of it. We make it suck to think about naughty things. So any loading. So here's a good example. What's that dog? What was Sarah's dog?
What was it?
It went after me today, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I was trying to think of the kind of dog it is.
I have no idea.
It's like an 80-pound. Well, it's a fat dog, though.
Big, though.
It needs to lose 30 pounds. So we'll call it a 90-pound dog. That should be a 60-pound dog. So it went after me today for something. I was fiddling with its muzzle. It went after me. And I couldn't give it a proper correction because I'm in front of all these people. I give the dog a pretty good correction, but I just lifted it up and gave it a good knee to the chest because I didn't want to be using foot taps at seminars. I got to be careful. And that alone dramatically helped. And then I went to the remote collar. So historically, what I'd like to do is give the dog a, if it goes after me or goes after a human, dominant dog collar, remote collar, and it's a combination of dominant dog collar up, remote collar high level. There's more details to this. I encourage you to do a Skype session, but just to give you an idea of what we do, and that we do that for 1 to 3 seconds. Boom, you're done. Now you work on all your other stuff with your counter conditioning protocols with the clicker and food. And then also you start correcting with the remote collar for loading or thinking naughty thoughts. That's what we do. Because this concept of like give a bunch of people food so it's your dog's best friend is bullshit. That's a great way for people to get bit. So please don't do that. Mm-hmm. Next.
Jesse from Fall River. What is a boofer? I have no idea. I have plenty of friends from Fall River. I've never heard of that.
Well, I'll tell you what. Tune in. What day of the week is today?
Saturday.
We're not going to do a show on Monday. We're traveling. Mm-hmm. What are we doing from the airport? What if we have a layover?
What are you, nuts?
If we have a layover, we can do one from the airport.
What are you, fucking nuts? You can try. Wi-Fi is probably going to be crap, though. An airport where everyone's trying to take it.
Excuse me. Anyway, what I'm going to say is we'll let you know on Monday what a boofer is.
Text Brittany.
Text Brittany right now.
I can't get off here.
Okay, you're right. Right.
Anirbis, isn't that Sabrina? I was dying last night yep. with your detailed filming of every specialty bread and fancy bakery goodie. So
Sabrina, yeah.
We didn't eat any of it.
We didn't eat any of it, I know.
Enlightened canine perspective, 11-year-old dog with severe OCD, other than making those behaviors suck. How do you handle this type of dog? Owners contemplating amputating his leg or euthanizing him.
Does he self-mutilate? If he self-mutilates, we use a remote collar to stop that. I mean, I'd hate to take off the dog's leg to eliminate the self-mutilation because the dog's got three other legs to mutilate, you know, and then you're fucked, right? They better start saving up for a wheelchair as well. I'd be really hesitant to just give you a YouTube live advice on that because it's the life or death of the dog or one of his appendages. So I'd encourage them or you to do a Skype session. I would need a lot more information before anybody made any rash decisions on this dog whatsoever. But OCD behaviors, we absolutely use remote collars and we make it suck to do that. You can also muzzle the dog. So it can't practice it. But a lot of it's probably arousal and state of mind. Arousal and state of mind. Next.
Official 7 Dog Squad. I appreciate your response and free info. We paid a trainer $400 plus to have her tell me they can never coexist again and to just rehome one. Thank you for giving us hope with our 2 bitchy bitches.
They're both females too. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So now your odds are stacked even higher against you. But this is the thing. If they didn't see, this is the thing. I can't give you good advice until I've worked with the dogs. Like for official 7 Dog Squad, how do you know these dogs aren't one correction away from getting along? They could be, literally. You make trying to fight suck beyond comprehension to a dog. The last thing these dogs are going to want to do is fight. It's possible. It can be done. We have done it. But for somebody to say, without working it, that chances are somebody came to the house and maybe observed them. That's cool. That's like, I don't need to observe your dogs. like, and I sure as hell wouldn't charge you $400 for it, because that just tells me where we are today. That gives me no information of where we'll be in 90 days from now. Like, if you showed me a video of your dogs fighting, I'd be like, yep, that's what dogs look like when they're fighting. I mean, I can tell you how severe it is, but it's like, yeah, they're fighting. I believed you the first time. That's a dog fight. Great. Now let's fix it. So the assessment comes when we start the work. But there's like, what kind of tests does somebody give? And I know they have tests, but like the dog's level one or level two, level four. My dog's been identified as a level three aggressive. What is that? The Dunbar test or something like that or whatever. It's like, who the fuck gives a shit? Good for you. You made up your own fucking test just to fucking get your ego stroked. What does it mean? What does it all mean? Does that mean a level five can't be rehabbed and a level one can be? And you're not taking into account of effect the skill set of the trainer and the skill set and knowledge of the owner, which are very important protocol, which are very, very important, you know, considerations. Also, are there other dogs in the house? Like, there's so many variables. So I'm not saying that it works. I'm just saying it's like, it can be done. And in the end, yeah, maybe you have to rehome one, but it's worth a try. Mm-hmm. Next.
Sebastian, tonight my stepmother said she wants me to neuter my 7-month-old dog so he won't start marking. Meanwhile, she wants a Malinois because it's cute. Some people shouldn't be allowed to own dogs.
The cool part about stepmoms is you don't have to fucking love them, right? That's the cool part about it. So the fact that your stepmom wants you to do something, I don't know how old you are, but who cares? Good for her. My mom wanted me to do a lot of stuff. Like, good for you, mom. That doesn't mean I'm going to do it. You know what I mean? So it's like, okay, great. Thanks. You know, if I want your opinion, I'd ask for it. So, and if she gets a Malinois, move out of the house. Next.
Rescues and focused dog training. I'm in LA. I will look forward to a future seminar.
So I don't do any in Los Angeles. My buddy Sean O'Shea, thegooddog.net, thegooddog.net is there. He's a great guy. You go to there. He's got a great team of trainers out there. But come to my Vegas seminar. Come to the Las Vegas seminar. Drive out. That'll be fun. Next.
Random American. Yep, my Roddy redirected and hit my elbow in a prong collar after correcting a lunge.
Mm-hmm. It happens. And if it wasn't on a room, if it wasn't on a prong collar, it most likely would have happened again. Still happened. Next.
Supreme Leader Snoke. Will spaying change my dog's character? Breeder said to spay, otherwise dog could turn mean. I prefer to delay spaying until she is older. Dog's an 8-month-old Weimaraner.
You have a stupid fucking ass breeder. I'll tell you that much. So sorry, but your breeder's ignorant. Your breeder's very, very ignorant. So talk to number one dog squad. Ask him if his dogs are spayed. They're probably not. There you go. There goes that point. Ask number one dog squad if his dogs are spayed.
What's that?
The dogs are fighting.
Oh.
His dogs are. There's two bitches are fighting.
Oh, gotcha.
You know. So I specialize in aggression rehab. That's my gig. And I can safely say 100%. Maybe there's like one or two a year that are not, but 100%, I guess that means it's not 100%, 99.99%, 99.98%, whatever, have been de-sexed. They're fucking aggressive. It's got nothing to do with aggression. It's not connected. The lack of your sexual organs and being able to reproduce have got nothing to do with aggression whatsoever. And anybody that says so, I'm sorry, you're full of shit. And you don't fucking know how to work with aggression. Next.
Shane, greetings from Prince Edward Island. LOL, I vouch for you, Jeff. Gotta say, at least four times to be considered Canadian. Thanks for your content, eh?
Yeah. You know what? I'd love to get up to Prince Edward Island.
Let's go.
We've got a super fan in Newfoundland.
It's cold up there, though.
And they make winter gear. So, next.
Caitlin, how did Joelle react to you being late this morning? That's fine.
She's fine.
Drinking my coffee.
She was drinking her coffee. She's freaking scrolling the gram.
Yeah.
She's scrolling the gram. She was fine. You know why? We were actually ahead.
Yeah, we were.
We were ahead. Yep. We got to the gym.
Before we even planned.
We got to the gym before 5:30, mm-hmm. which is unusual.
Probably like 5:15.
Yeah. What are we, 15 minutes away from the gym? Do we stop at Starbucks first or Starbucks after?
After.
Start at Starbucks. Yeah. Yeah. We got to the gym early this morning. Next.
Nancy, I'm from Wisconsin. That's the accent. Wisconsin. Yeah. Number one pit bull dad. Hey, Jeff, my dog is so well behaved. People are asking where I took her for training. I referred them to your YouTube. I would also like the info for your Skype sessions.
So, number one pit bull dad, if you go to solidcaninetraining.com, Melissa might put a link down below. I just haven't seen it yet. Solidcaninetraining.com. Go to the shopping cart. You actually can purchase that's how many Skypes that I do. You actually can purchase a Skype on our shopping carts. Jessica gets that email and she will then email you and schedule it. And it just shows up in my calendar. Next.
Pichu, there's a way on teaching, or I'm assuming that, is there a way on teaching a dog how to sit like a normal dog instead of putting his back legs in weird ways?
So I don't do confirmation and I don't do competition. I don't really care how dogs sit. I just want them to sit. Mm-hmm. So I'm the wrong guy to ask on that. I would talk to a confirmation or a competition obedience person. They probably have some ideas on that one. I'm just a basic pet dog trainer. Next.
Barb, the alpha is always in the back of the pack. Can't say thank you enough. You are a godsend. My dogs have done a total 180, staying in cages quietly and not destroying anything. Oh my God, thank you. All caps.
Barb, thank you for the kind words. Thank you for the hearts. Thank you for the little heart. Really call that the heart bomb.
Emoji.
I really love that a lot. So thank you. All your kind words are great. Next.
Eric, my lab growls and barks at the door and people behind it. He is okay after people are in the house. How would you control the growl and barking?
We'd stop it. So we would eliminate it. And I would get a bonker. I don't have a bonker on me now. It's at the seminar. It's just a rolled up towel. Watch my YouTube video from last night and then watch my two other videos on YouTube. It's you say no and then bonk. So watch the one that I made last night that really, really takes you through it. And then you can watch the one on how to make one next.
Pichu, working on that sit stay now. There is some drool here, using treats from time to time to reward duration.
Yeah. The drool could be from the anticipation of the food for all we know, right? So definitely dogs, it's a stressor. It's a stressor for them and they drool. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Have them sit on a towel. Next.
Crystal, hey, Jeff and Joelle. I've used the e-collar on Max to get the dog to stop barking at the door when a guest comes over, but she's extremely vocal. She stops, but then the next day she does the same thing. Am I doing something wrong?
Yeah, you might not be. I would use the bonker. I would go to a bonker. It's possible you're not going high enough. And also how many...
I've used it on the max effort. I've used it on max to get the dog.
Holy shit. So I would try the bonker. No. And then bonk. And then also, what's the rest of the day look like with the dog? How are you holding the dog accountable for other things? Are you doing duration work? And obviously proper... I don't mention exercise and nutrition. It's a given. Okay? Exercise your dogs for a fair amount of time. Teach a proper, feed a proper diet. We feed raw. You don't have to feed raw, but we feed raw. Mm-hmm. And teach your dog obedience commands. That's a given, just because I don't mention it. Okay? So, but we're problem solving here. We're problem solving here. Next. So I'm sorry. So what I mean by that is, are you holding your dog accountable in any other part of its life? Are you allowing your dog free roam? Do you not hold your dog accountable? Are you slack on your obedience? Are you over affectionate with your dog? Do you keep your dog? Are you sleeping with your dog? Are you being too affectionate, or are you being really, really, really firm right now? Next.
Teresa, I have a rescue pup, 10 months, shepherd husky. She jumps up and bites the leash and sometimes gets my hand. I don't have a shock collar. P.S. I love you.
You're welcome. I love you too. What I would do is, I'd give the dog a good old-fashioned heel tap for doing that. So you can get a pet convincer. It all depends on how much you know, how physical you want to be with your dog. You know, this is the thing. I've got no problem. Like when it comes down to, there's some things I have no problem being physical with because it's like, they respond to that. So if a dog bit my hand and bit up on the leash, first of all, that's a choice. That's a choice a dog makes. So what I don't want you to do is pull up on the leash because you're just going to play tug of war with a dog. So also pulling up on the leash is a choice. Pulling up on a leash is a choice. The dog doesn't have to bite the leash. What we do is dog's biting the leash. Yeah. My foot goes out. And I just heel tap the dog. Next.
Canned jam. Dog is doing great using your techniques. I have her on a prong, walk her with a perfect heel, but she is still going crazy when she sees other dogs lunging, snarling. I interrupt with no effect.
Don't interrupt. You have to massively extinguish it. So I would use a remote collar for that. But this is what I would do is at the beginning, we do the pre-walk punisher. We bonk the dog. All our leash reactive dogs, we start out the walk. You go out of the house. Dog starts scanning. No, bonk. Switch to remote collar. The slightest glance anywhere, correct. All right? You're missing the arousal point. You're missing the arousal point. The dog is escalating, and then you lost it. Next.
Erica, I have 5 dogs. I'm in the process of teaching place using bed.
Please do.
I have many beds for them to choose from. Is it necessary for each to have their own bed, or is it okay for them to just be on a bed?
Okay. Hopefully you don't. Okay. This is it. So yes, but the way you worded it, this, they have many beds to choose from. Maybe I'm just taking this the wrong way. I don't want them to choose what beds they go on. I want you to dictate what beds they go on. You there. Don't move. You have 5 dogs. You got a pack. Run it like we run our boarding train. Got it? Next.
Kim, good evening, Jeff. Been a long time since I've seen you on YouTube. I hope things are going well with you and Linda and the family.
Kim, we're here 3 times a week. How is everything in New Orleans? I was just in New Orleans.
Probably like a month ago.
Not longer than that. I picked up the RV.
It was like in March at some point. First week of March.
Right? Yeah. So I was just down in New Orleans picking up my RV. So I was only there for a couple of days. Things are going well. Thank you so much for asking. Next.
Becca, well said, Jeff.
No.
Cool. Josue, get some good sleep after this, guys.
Love, I know, man. I think tonight I will.
This is awesome.
I know. This is I, but I love this though. Mm-hmm. This is what I love. You know what I love about this? Where most people would say, you know what, we've done enough today. I'm like, can't. Mm-hmm. We can't. As much as we drag and as hard as it is to be enthusiastic, the show must go on.
Sure.
There's so many people out there that need help. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of people out there that need help. And I just think that it's like, if we're close to the internet, mm-hmm. if we can get a signal, there's no fucking excuse why not to do a show. Unless we're like if we were at a dinner. Mm-hmm. Or if there was an event we had to go to, mm-hmm. or I'm traveling by myself. Sometimes I can't, which isn't going to be happening at all till the end of the year.
Yeah.
There's weeks that when you're on vacation, I probably won't be able to do a show, but you know what though? By then I bet you I'll be able to grab somebody else from the office.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe get little Zoe to do it.
Maybe. So that's going to be weird, huh? No Joelle for a whole week, guys.
I would feel probably, I can swear in front of Linda, swear in front of you.
You can't swear in front of the intern.
I can't swear in front of the intern.
I was an intern at one point. You swore in front of me.
Yeah, I know.
It's different though.
Yeah. We'll see how it goes. But yeah, we'll doubt the show will go on without Joelle.
Yep.
Unless she dictates to me that I can't do
you
it.
You can't do a show without me.
But just to let you know. Just to let you know.
Jeff's going to do all the social media that week, too.
That's something she would say.
I actually get a whole week of, like, relaxing on the beach.
You think you can do that?
I'm going to try.
You think you can do it?
You'll probably see me on my personal Instagram.
That I don't care.
Posting stupid
stuff. I don't care about that.
Yeah. You might go crazy. Jeff, I'm coming back tomorrow.
Jeff, can you please give me some videos to edit?
Right. I don't know. We'll see. Ellie, thank you, Jeff, for all of your free content. My puppy is learning fast using your techniques. I was wondering if it's okay to apply a harsh e-collar correction to a puppy. Thanks again.
How old's the puppy and what's it for? Next.
JJ, hello, Jeff and Joelle. I enjoy your live streams.
Thank you, JJ.
Karen, do you recommend that dogs are always left in a crate when we are not at home, even though they're not destructive?
Depending on the other behavior. I mean, if you've had an easy peasy dog, no separation anxiety, no leash reactivity, no resource guarding, no aggression, doesn't do selective hearing, what do I care? Next.
Zach, thank you for all the advice you gave me the other day. My American Pit Bull Terrier walks nicely on the leash now.
Awesome. Woo-hoo! Cool.
Sandra, LOL, Joelle is so low maintenance. I was hesitant to mention and compliment her do.
Wow, nice.
Ultra half hazard. What do you do with a very dog reactive dog who will scream at other dogs and flip out? We try to prong improperly using it, try to hard no and bonkers, and he still does it.
He screams when he sees other dogs?
Mm-hmm.
So this is the thing. What I would do, this is what we do with a lot of these dogs. Before we even introduce them to a situation like that, what we do is this. Is we work these dogs inside on a lot of different protocols, and we hold them accountable for a lot of small things. We do a lot of structure, a lot of leadership, a lot of guidance, hold them accountable. Then what we do is we take them for the walk. And then we make sure the walk looks really good. Remote collar heel walk. We find that that makes everything easier instead of like just going out into the belly of the beast right off the bat. Next.
Pedro, hi Jeff, you're the best. Gonna tag you in all my doggy Instagrams now.
Oh, awesome. Thank you.
Samantha, had an amazing time at Frederick getting to meet you both. Thank you for all the help. Walking our dog is so much better. Little things I need to change and it's so much easier. Thank you both.
Oh, wow. Awesome.
Paraz, on walk with 1 year GSD, we met a crowd of teen girls who asked to pet him. He's usually very friendly, but was scared and wanted nothing to do with them. As four or five of them approached him, how do I correct
things? You don't let teen girls approach your dog. I would never, ever allow that. I had one dog, Uma, you can do that with. No dog I own now. I would never want to put my dog underneath that kind of pressure. So sorry, you know, sorry, ladies. I really appreciate, you know, it for asking, but my dog isn't going to want to do this. So next.
JJ, I get you, Jeff. You can give no shits about what people think about you and still be caring and compassionate.
Thanks, JJ. Truth right there.
Amy, but you're not a dick. You're realistic.
That's up for debate.
She put little like asterisks for dick, but I just said it.
Right.
It's okay, Amy. You can swear here. Yep. That's not even a swear. Megan, dog is so out of tune with owner. Prong doesn't phase. Program is...
Prong,
yep. Prong is fitted properly and timing was good. I'm going to try e-collar during board and train and engagement exercises. Curious, what would Jeff do?
So this is a client's dog. If the dog, okay, then it's your job.
Dog has been worked on prong for a year or two. I think she's numb to it by now.
So Megan, it's your job then to teach the owner. It's your job to teach the owner. That's what we do. Okay, next.
Bonnie, my dog has stopped responding to the e-collar mini educator. Even him going back to a prong, what can I do?
Number one, make sure your remote's on, make sure it's actually working. So make sure test it on, there's a light or just test it on your hand. Also, sometimes you have to go back to basics, not often, but go back to basics. Next.
Bonnie, thanks so much.
You're welcome.
Bianca, just watched a 180 video. Sounds really good.
Cool. Next.
Julian, hello. We have a mini educator. Our dog gets very scared of it once it's on, reacts abruptly on level two. We've gone up to 100 for fence fighting. She runs inside the house, but still continues the next day.
Wow. You might have a special case. You might have a really, really special case. That's another dog that I'd be like, okay, believe it or not, this is going to sound crazy, guys. Totally fucking crazy. You know those sparklet bottles, the water bubbler bottles? They're the 5 gallon bottles and a barker. This is going to sound so mean, so abusive. I get it. Fence fighting. It's horrific. It sucks. Dogs going fence fighting. Say no. Sparklet bottle, bonker, remote collar. Like, Jesus Christ, Jeff. That's so fucking abusive. listen, it should be a one-shot deal. Like, when we want to stop, and like, nobody's ever heard me say that before.
No, I'm actually like sitting here going, damn, it's putting all out there tonight.
Yeah, yeah. Nobody's ever heard me say that before. Mm-mm. 800 shows. Probably what? 100,000 answers. Mm-hmm. But there's a time when nothing else is working and you're doing it right. Or you think you're doing it right. And you've listened to all my other advice and everything else in the house is going great. So remember who asked that question?
Julian,
remember how I said, what's the rest of the day look like? What's the rest of the day look like? Are you giving the dog total freedom inside? Can it be a dick inside? Can it be reactive inside? Can it do all this? If you're not, do that too. Do that first. But if you're doing all that stuff and there's still that reactivity for rushing front doors or fence fighting, rules change. Overwhelming. Boom, boom. Holy shit. You're not going to hurt your dog. Like, none of the stuff will hurt the dog, guys. None of this stuff will hurt the dog at all. But it's going to be overwhelming to the dog. And guess what? Hopefully it's done. Next.
Mayra, hey, Jeff, can you give advice to stop our one-year-old husky from jumping on people when he
needs Oh, God, yeah. I can fix that for you in 3 seconds. Go to my YouTube video, how to stop dogs from jumping. It literally takes 3 seconds to do. Next.
Enlightened canine perspective. The dog that is obsessive compulsive has done every 6 days, and it's the first time in 2 years he hasn't had to wear a comb to prevent self-mutilating his leg. Of course, he still needs a lot of work. The biggest challenge is going to be me telling the owners that the stressful environment they have the dog living in is a real issue. I'll be at your seminar next week in Atlanta.
Yeah. So it just goes to show change of environment can help. Next. Good.
Christian, where do you get all your information?
Where do I get all my information? 7,000 dogs, all trial and error, not from a book, not from repeating other people's information, no, from no white papers, from no studies, literally from hands-on results of doing the work. I've only been doing this for 14 years, but I've trained a lot of dogs and all of them with massive amounts of behavioral issues. I don't work with easy dogs. I have worked with some easy dogs, but I work with extremely difficult dogs with extremely difficult and dangerous behaviors. I tour the world doing seminars, working hands-on, and there's that 7,000 dogs there, massive amounts of results, trial and error, shitloads of success, a couple of failures, and then massive amounts of feedback from the millions of people that watch our advice online that are also then doing what I tell them to do, and they're getting the results. Therefore, with all this body of information, I feel confident to give out this advice, knowing that if it's applied properly, it'll work. Now, if it's applied improperly, you're probably not going to fuck up the dog. People fuck up their dogs without me. Like, you don't need me to fuck up your dog. Like, every single dog, I just did a post called "I Show Up at the Scene of the Crime." It's on Facebook and Instagram. Read it. All these dogs coming to me, they come to me with the worst behaviors ever. I'm not in the picture. So they already came to me fucked up. So I don't create any of the bad behaviors. So that's pretty much where my information comes from. So I'm not repeating something that somebody told me. I'm not repeating. And I just say this because a lot of people do that. They're like, I heard. It's like, well, you heard, but I do. I did. I, you know what I mean? So when I'm saying that is because it's like, I've done the work. I still do the work today. So a lot of the stuff that I'm preaching tonight, I did this afternoon. So next.
Mo, thanks Jeff. At the moment, using prong collar, muzzle, bonker, bought e-collar. This week announced soon to be legal, but I haven't introduced yet. Was advised to wait as she just got in heat first time. Makes sense.
Dogs are in heat. I don't put a lot of pressure on my Kira. I do my own personal dog. I do. Cause I've been working here for long enough and I know her, you know, I can work her heat or no hurt heat. Like that ain't no, it's like, yo bitch, that ain't no fucking excuse not to work. You know what I mean? So that's it. Next.
Okay. Melissa posted links to your Skype.
Thanks.
JJ, is a bonker just a throwing device, or do you hold it and bonk the dog too?
Both. Next.
Shalanda, hey, J times two.
Hey, Shalanda.
Allie, 4 months old for counter surfing. He's an XL pit bull, so he's able to reach everything now. Also chasing other animals, with chickens and cats.
Okay, counter surfing, I'd get a remote collar on that dog, make it suck to counter surf. But let's just do this. Make it suck to counter surf, make it suck to chase animals, which is like, normally we don't do that at a 16-week-old dog, but let's start freaking eliminating this shit now. Next.
Bonnie. He twitches on high and keeps doing the behavior I'm trying to get rid of. Thanks for the info.
Oh, appreciate so it's best. Not so it's not a powerful enough collar. It's not a powerful enough collar. Believe it or not, if you're using a mini educator, that's the lowest level collar that they make. They make them 4 times stronger. So you might need a more powerful collar. Next.
Last one. Christian.
We are? Yeah. Oh, shit. Here we are last week. Good. I'm glad it's the last one. We're done.
We're starting our first official live next week on animal rescue. What do you suggest for attracting animal lovers on YouTube?
What do I suggest for attracting animal lovers on YouTube? Oh, geez. Just putting out massive amounts of content. So you probably want to talk to a YouTube analytics person. You want to do that? You can do... you can do a lot of ads that you can do on, you can do YouTube advertising. You can do Instagram ads with swipe ups that go to your YouTube channel. You can do Facebook that go to your YouTube channel. You can do in-store, IG, I'm so tired. You can do IG stories in them advertisements. So you can do that. There's a lot of different ways right now. Very, very low with very low CPM. So you can do that next. But I'm not an expert on that. So I'm not. I just keep putting out shit. And if people see my stuff, they do. If they don't, they don't. So next.
That's it.
Oh, that's it. Oh.
Next. Hope to stay here till tomorrow.
All right. That's good. All right. Guys, I'm done. I was done 5 minutes into this show. I think.
Done at 7 o'clock.
Yeah, I know. Is your room this loud?
It's so loud. Because
I'm above the lobby.
Playing fucking bocce ball down there or something.
Because I'm above the lobby. You're farther down. You still hear it?
Yes.
Jesus Christ.
I'm back too. I keep hearing people out there.
What side of the hall are you on?
This side.
Same side as I am?
Mm-hmm.
That's a big field.
I know. People got dogs or something out there. They're barking and
it's
stuff.
In the middle of the night.
Yes. We both said it would be a good place to run dogs.
Oh, yeah, I know.
And obviously someone's doing it.
It's 9 o'clock at night. They can make noise down there.
Yeah, I know.
I'm gonna talk to Karen and find out what the curfew is, though, in this place. Mm-hmm. When's quiet time in this place?
Seriously. But, like, the 80-year-olds are keeping us up. They're all, like, twice our age. And we're the tired, cranky ones.
Everybody should go down.
Quiet down, Dad.
All right, guys. Anyway. So it's been a good show.
Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow's going to be the good second day of the seminar. I think we should do an IG stories down there. Let's do that. Let's sit in the lobby and just be like,
okay,
let's do that.
Let everyone see what's going on.
Yeah. All right, guys. Check into our Instagram. I'll show you the nonsense downstairs.
Crazy.
All right, guys. Madly in love with you. I feel honored and blessed to be here. Thank you guys all for tuning in. Thanks for all the top chats. Thanks for all the wonderful questions. IG stories, our Instagram, jump on there. Jump on our YouTube channel, which you're on now, but check all of our videos out. If you have not subscribed to the channel, subscribe, hit notification, give us a thumbs up. Guys, if you want to give me a thumbs down, that's fine. If you don't like the show, it actually doesn't bother me whatsoever. I don't expect people to agree with everything I say at all. There are things that I talk about that are on here that are absolutely somebody would be uncomfortable with. That's okay. Pick what you feel will work for you. But if you're still struggling and I keep giving out the same advice week after week, but you are uncomfortable doing it, there's probably a reason why I keep giving that advice. That could be the answer. Just think about that. I never want anybody to do anything that they're morally against at all. But if we truly want to rehab our dogs, sometimes we do have to step out of our comfort zone, but that's within our moral boundaries. I get it. But let's just think about big picture stuff and how much we want to struggle. And then if you say to yourself, you know what, 1 to 3 seconds of discomfort for months or years of really good stuff, I'm sorry, in my book, That's worth it. That's worth it. All right. Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. This is Joel. Guys, thank you so much. Everybody have a wonderful, wonderful evening. Okay. Bye-bye.